Hello, my name is Sean McClowry, and I'm a professor of music industry at the College of St. Rose. I'm here today making this video in collaboration with the College of St. Rose Music Industry Program and the Les Paul Foundation. In this video, I'll be demonstrating several different kinds of analog recording methods that were championed by the great Les Paul. Les Paul was the most influential innovator of modern recording. He paved the way for rock and roll and for the kind of multi-track recording that we benefit from using today. In this video, I'll be going way back to the origins of his work, which will be a demonstration on record cutting. Right here, I have a lacquer disc, which is what records, master records, are cut to. And I'll be demonstrating cutting to this lacquer disc today. This is specifically a particular kind of recording, which is called direct-to-disc recording. So what I'll be doing is I'll be playing some music and recording it directly onto this disc and then playing it back. Now, this kind of recording, direct-to-disc recording, might be the most pure form of recording that we have even today. And that might come as a surprise to many of you to hear that statement, being that we have digital recording today, which sonically is sounding very pure and uncolored. But yet direct-to-disc recording is literally sound waves that are driving a stylus to cut waveforms onto a disc. And then the playing back of those exact waveforms on a turntable or a record player. Through this process, there's no conversion whatsoever. And in other forms of recording, say digital recording, where analog sound is converted to digital bits, there's conversion that happens in that process. And even in magnetic analog tape recording, like I have here on the screen, an analog tape recorder, there's even conversion that happens in that process. But in this form of recording, this is the most pure. We're going to be playing back the waveforms that we will record onto this disc. So let's see how it goes. So here's some of the equipment we're working with here. I'm in a kind of a makeshift studio, cutting studio in my basement, because I cannot go to our recording studio at school. But this here is our record cutter. This is a Presto 6N. It was kind of designed around World War II. This one is a little bit later than that, probably from about 1950 or so. There's a disc that I've been working with that's a lacquer disc. Lacquer discs are also called acetate discs, but lacquer discs are basically, they are nail polish, which is what lacquer is, on top of a metal plate. Since you can't even see the metal plate, but the thing I'm holding in my hand has a metal plate in the middle of it, and lacquer on both sides of it. And it's kind of a malleable material that can be easily etched in with a stylus, with a cutting stylus. So this record cutting lathe was made possible through a grant to the College of St. Rose by the Les Paul Foundation. And Les Paul is one of the great pioneers of recording, multi-track recording and sound-on-sound recording. I'll do some demonstrations on him in some future videos. So here's a box of brand new lacquer discs. So yeah, this is just there's 25 of these discs in here, and I'll be cutting on one of these today. So this turntable, or platter, spins around, and over here I've got a cutting stylus. It's a cutter head, also made by Presto. It's a Presto 1C cutter head, and you can see the stylus just below it. That's the thing that etches onto the disc. The stylus is sapphire or ruby. This particular one is sapphire. Connected to the cutter head is this thing, which is a heater, and this thing heats the stylus. It's made by Fairchild. Fairchild made a very famous compressor called the Fairchild 660. But it heats the stylus so that there's a little bit of heat when the grooves are cutting into the record, and it just helps the fidelity and the signal to noise ratio. Let's see, what else can I show you on this? This is kind of cool. This particular record cutting lathe was used in the Army Signal Corps. I'm guessing that it may have been a part of the Signal Corps during the Korean War. This lathe, which is probably about 100 pounds, was supposed to be portable. Today it's, you know, that's, for portability, that's pretty heavy, but it's possible that that was portable. So here's how it works. The cutter head gets put over so that it's in a cutting position on the disc. And the cutter head advances along through this thing, which is called a feed screw. You can see there's threads on it. And as I engage this part, which is the knife that allows it to advance along the feed screw, and I lower the cutter head, then I'm going to cut grooves onto the disc. I'll do this for real in just a minute. But as it cuts along the disc, the feed screw advances the cutter head towards the center of the disc. Now, there are a couple wires connected to the disc, or to the cutter head, excuse me, and those wires go through some wires over here. They go through to those wires over here, and they are driven by an amplifier that's down here. And that amplifier gets its sound source from something put into the little mixer here. So I can put something from the computer, or what I like to do is I like to send some sound from this, which is an Ampex 350 reel-to-reel tape machine from the same era, about 1951, 1952-ish. So we can use this as a sound source to send a recording to the cutting lathe. Or we can record directly from a microphone, and that's what we'll do today. So I'll record from a microphone through the mixer into the cutting lathe. Well, into the amplifier, then into the cutter head onto the lathe. Now, one thing I neglected to mention was the records. If you have a record player at home, you might have seen that the output of your record at home might say phono, or a receiver or a preamp that you might have might also have a phono input, and that input has a certain equalization curve, and so in order to cut records so that it is working with that equalization curve, we need to introduce something called a inverse RIAA encoder, and that's what this is here. This is a homemade inverse RIAA encoder that I literally made from scratch for this purpose. So this encodes the EQ curve that is necessary to etch onto the disc. Now without that, the grooves that are cut onto the disc will be too wide and too fat, and it'll make the record skip. So in order to maximize the amount of audio information that can be put onto those grooves, you have to put this encoder in there, in the signal chain. When I record today, I'm going to use my Ampex machine to provide me with a delay, a slap delay. Les Paul had used this when he was recording. He was really the first to use this kind of delay effect on his guitar and the vocals with Mary Ford. It was later used by producers such as Sam Phillips. In fact, this was the exact kind of delay of Ampex 350 that Sam Phillips would have used. So I'll do a song today that Sam Phillips recorded just to demonstrate this. So this delay will be mixed into the signal and then cut onto the record cutting lathe. And, you know, I've got a microphone, so I'll be cutting through the microphone, playing with the delay in there. Okay. Okay, so I've got a brand new lacquer on there, lacquer disc, and I'm about to record this song, so I'm going to turn on the heating stylus. And let's get her started here. Engage the platter. And I'm going to move the overhead mechanism onto the disc. Okay, there we go. So the stylus is kind of hovering just over the disc there. And I'm going to engage the knife, which starts to have the cutter head travel along the disc through these threads that are pushing it towards the center. And then I'm going to lower the carriage or the fork onto the disc. And so you start to see grooves forming now. And you also see this thread there. So that's the negative or the swarf of the groove. So we're cutting now. So I'm going to Ampex tape delay working. And get my guitar out. I think we're ready. So here we go. Blue moon, blue moon, blue moon, keep on shining bright. Blue moon, keep on shining bright. You're gonna bring me back to my baby tonight. Blue moon, keep on shining bright. I said blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining. Shine on the one that's gone and left me blue. I said blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining. Shine on the one that's gone, let me bloom. Well, it was one moonlight night, the stars shine bright, the wish blown high, love said goodbye. I said blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining. Shine on the one that's gone, let me bloom. Let's see how that came out. Okay, I'm done recording. So you can see the disc, which is still etching, the cutter head still etching into the disc, and you can see the grooves on there. So I just lifted up the stylus so it's no longer touching the disc, and I'm going to move this over to the edge. Now you can see all this like fur, and that's the grooves that have been cut, and it's what's called the swarf. So I'll stop this, and I'm gonna take off the mechanism here, put it onto there, and I'm gonna try to get that swarf off of there. So oop, it just fell right off. Now I'll tell you, I've got a bunch of this swarf here. It's actually very flammable, so hopefully there's no fire in here, because it'll go up in smoke. All right, so I can actually play this now with our tone arm. So I'll put our tone arm onto the disc and see how it sounds.
Blue moon, blue moon, blue moon, keep on shining bright. Blue moon, keep on shining bright. You're gonna bring me back to my baby tonight. Blue moon, keep on shining bright. I said blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining. Shine on the one that's gone and left me blue. I said blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining. Shine on the one that's gone and left me blue. Well, it was one moonlight night, the stars shined bright, the wish blown high, love said goodbye. I said, blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining. Shine on the one that's gone and left me blue.
Okay, so we made our direct-to-disc recording onto this lacquer disc. And I just want to talk a little bit about the sound of that recording. You heard it on the video. Now, obviously, to get it on the video, it had to be converted to digital format. So you're not hearing it here in an analog sense, but you get a good idea of how it sounded. To me, it sounded really like a record, like what I'm familiar with when I listen to an LP on vinyl. The difference is that you might notice that there's very little surface noise with this. Cutting into a lacquer is pretty clean sounding. There's a little bit of surface noise, but if I were to record, say, at a different speed, this recording was done at 33 and a third RPM, which most of your records that you might play on, most of your vinyl records are at 33 RPM if they're this size, 12-inch discs. But if I were to record at a higher speed, say 78 RPM, which is what the Presto 6N really sounds very good at, you would hear an increased fidelity, and it would just sound even more present than it does at this speed. It sounded pretty good, I thought. So, and you might have noticed there was a little bit of distortion in there. That's something I should probably manage. I could probably bring that distortion down. I was probably pushing it a little too hard on the amplifier, but we can, you know, manage that with more practice. I will say, now some of you might have seen that demonstration. Maybe it looked kind of easy. It took years, 2 years, to get to this point to be able to cut these kinds of discs. It takes a lot of practice. These machines take a lot of maintenance, and there are very few people that can work on those machines. So it really means that if you are interested in doing record cutting and you wanted to dig into it, find a machine to do it, it's a long journey. It's a lot of fun, but it's a long and expensive journey. For example, this lacquer disc, this costs $25 per lacquer disc. There's two sides on it, but what can happen with these discs is you can record onto them and use them as a master disc that you then send to a record pressing plant. The record pressing plant would take a negative image with a metal plate of the lacquer disc, and that metal plate will become the master plate by which all vinyl records could be pressed to, and that's how we get vinyl recordings. So this is just the first step in creating vinyl records. Another way of recording that a lot of people do that have these kind of record lathes today is called embossing. And embossing discs onto polycarbonate, embossing recordings onto polycarbonate discs. I have a polycarbonate disc here. I mean, it's really just a piece of plastic. And you can record onto this. The fidelity is not as good as a lacquer disc, but, you know, if you're making recordings for a band, maybe you want to make like 25, 30 recordings for a band or artist, and this is a pretty affordable way to go. These cost maybe like $1 or $2 each, but there's other equipment with record cutting that's fairly expensive, so it's not easy, but it's possible today. So going back to one of the things I said at the beginning of this video was that direct to disc recording or record cutting is perhaps one of the most pure forms of recording that we have available today. And that is in comparison to all the other forms like analog magnetic tape recording or digital recording. This form of recording is a stylus etching in waveforms onto a disc and then playing back those exact waveforms on a record player. There's no conversion whatsoever in that process. And while it sounds like a vintage format, there's still something very pure about the sound of those records. So it's always surprising to me actually how good it can sound, even though this is a very old technology. And for me, the kind of recording that I like doing when I record bands or singer-songwriters, I like to have some color when I record. I like to hear the machines that I'm using. They have some character that I really like. And I think it goes back to a lot of the old recordings that I grew up on or that I just love listening to today were made on all those kinds of machines. So when I hear those machines and that technology in there, to me, it's a welcome sound. I hope you all enjoyed this video. Look out for upcoming videos. The next one will be devoted to sound-on-sound recording and particularly focused on Les Paul's pioneering achievements with sound-on-sound recording, also using the record cutting lathe. So we'll see you the next time.